never be prepared enough for life's surprises or its eventualities. While death is a morbid thought, what could be worse than passing on without the means to help ease the grief of those we leave behind? Hi, this is Shop Talk. I'm Ria Tanwat-Cotrillo. In this episode, we talk about estate planning and find out how we should prepare for the best and the worst in life and in death. Sure, our estate and property and everything we acquire in life is in place and works for the people we care for, whether we're still around to enjoy them or when we get to the end of the road. Here to walk us through the must-dos for good estate planning is Attorney Liwayway Vinzons-Chato, Managing Partner of the Chato and Vinzons-Chato Law Offices. Attorney, thank you for coming on Shop Talk.
My pleasure, Ria.
All right, this is really your specialty, estate planning and all of that. Could you define for us exactly what it means?
Well, you have to have an estate to enjoy life. I mean, you should have properties. And to have those properties, you should be able to create one, an estate. And that estate should be able to provide you in life as well as leave something behind for your loved ones. So it's very important that everyone should have an estate plan. And that is even what I hope would improve the situation in the country, where people would think more about material wealth that they can create for themselves and be self-sufficient. Because a number of times, people just think that they can rely on somebody else to take care of them in times of contingencies, and when they're not around, somebody will take care of their children, and that's so unfair. So I've always been proposing that people should be taught estate planning, and this is what we're doing. And part of estate planning is not just the creation and the preservation of your wealth, material wealth, but also making sure that this is transferred with less hassle to your heirs, and that whatever is left behind will ensure liquidity and safety. Because when you don't have an estate plan, very often the estate that you leave behind might be taxed and you're going to lose most of it, or just go to debts or to some sibling rivalries that could create friction among all your kids. So all of these things is meant to prepare for that eventuality.
All right. Okay. So let's just say an individual did not go into estate planning and he has several properties and several children. What does the law provide for in that situation?
When there is no will that is left behind and no trust deed that is left behind, that person is considered to have died intestate. Intestate means that these heirs will have to agree among themselves how to divide that property. But the law has a provision that all those left behind, the wife, if there would be more than one child, if the wife, spouse, unfair for me to just talk of the wife, husbands included. Spouses who are left behind together with the children would get equal shares. Now, if there would be others, if there is no child left and there would just be a spouse, if there would still be the ascendants, the parents, then they also participate. So it's a little complicated. That's why it's important that there should be some planning that would provide for what happens to your property. Because for those who have been focusing on earning the wealth and providing for themselves, sometimes they don't even enjoy their estate. Very important. And this is one beautiful mental health story that I've learned. There is this doctor, Dr. Banks, who said, if you're going to prepare a will, your will should read like this. Being of sound mind and body, I spent all my money while I was alive.
Tapos ang kwento.
So that wala daw pag-aawayan yung mga bata. But that's not correct either, you know. You really have to look at events in your life that you'll have to provide for. And it's unfair if you have kids or you have a spouse who would be depending on you.
Right. So how would you describe the situation in the Philippines when it comes to estate planning? I mean, the impression I get is not enough Filipinos are doing it and they're not doing it properly.
And that is correct. I hear sad stories all around about estate that have been left without any provisions for a plan. And they experience difficult times with the Bureau of Internal Revenue. If the estate is anything which is 200,000 and above, you know, you're supposed to report already your estate and get a clearance if this is you would leave assets like land, shares of stocks, and cars, or the ones that would require registration in order to transfer them. But if you just leave behind gold bullions, or if you leave behind paintings, you know, and you don't need any registration, then you don't worry about that, because it's difficult for the government to go after those things, unless you really have the heirs declaring that, you know. Mm-hmm. So for the tangible assets that are left behind that would require registration for transfer, these are the ones that are causing difficulties for those who leave an estate behind. So you talk about how to save on taxes, how to reduce the cost of transfer, and how to make sure that when the time comes and suddenly you're not around anymore, somebody who knows how to manage the property will do it efficiently and not dissipate it. So those are the things that you attend to when you have an estate plan.
All right. So how does one get started if they want to, you know, start planning for when they're no longer around? The first thing to do is consult a lawyer.
Yes, but there's
one
no
like
need.
You, right?
You know, I, if I can be asked, I'd like to propose one subject in high school or in college, if that is possible. I'd prefer high school, that it be part of the high school curriculum. That there should be a part where you teach the children how to create that estate. You know, how to make sure that they will earn. And one of those ways first to create an estate is in order to create that estate, you can start with an insurance. And I think the insurance companies love me because of this. I would say, take out an insurance on your life and make sure that that insurance will cover you for eventualities. And when you start saving, you know, that also helps the country. This is a form of savings. Insurance, kasi you cannot get the proceeds until right. certain conditions have been met. In the case of just putting your savings in the savings account of banks, no, in banks, you can withdraw it anytime. So I always say it's better to have an insurance, which is what I've done, you know, early on in life, while you're still young. You
it's
take out an
insurance.
You're right. And so when you have reached a certain age, when you need money, you can even borrow against that. Or you can assign it or, you know, do something about it.
Right. Okay, say I'm planning my estate and I'm not planning to distribute everything evenly among my children. Mm-hmm. Right? I'm going to give this one this property, this one, all my paintings, and this one, all my cars and a country club share, yes. or something like that. And the children, you know, are told this, mm-hmm. and they're not happy.
Okay.
Okay. What happens then? You know, they will contest my will, you know, and they'll fight amongst themselves. Mm-hmm. How do you fix that?
Well, first of all, whoever will leave property behind should know that there is, in law, such a thing as a thing called legitim. And this legitim means whether you like it or not, no one should receive a portion that is less than what that person, the child, or that that heir is entitled to. So let's say you have one half of your property under the law is required as a forced inheritance to all your heirs. The other half you can dispose freely. So if you want to give a little more to one child who is disadvantaged, let's say that child is mentally disabled, then you can give a little more. And it's always, as I would mention in my talks, good to not just leave a material will or a trust, taking care of the material properties, but leave an ethical will. In an ethical will, here you write down, you can actually have it dictated to your lawyer for the lawyer to craft how that ethical will would look like. But it's always good to think about what you will say while you're doing things. And you can also leave that in a living trust, you know, your justification, why you're giving some assets to some or more than the others. So it's very, very important that you just don't attend to a distribution, because you want to prevent quarrels when you're not around anymore, or contest about what you have left behind. So in fact, I've read somewhere about the problem of one big heiress in the United States whose will has been contested, and has been contested for the longest time, because that heiress decided, she submitted a poem to one literary magazine, which was refused or rejected.
No? This was in her younger years.
In her younger years. And because of that, she gave up writing poetry and instead went to pharmaceuticals. And she established a big pharmaceutical company that earned billions already. But she decided to leave in her will some of these assets. The children contested it. But without any explanation why she decided to come up with that legacy to this magazine, mm-hmm. then you really you come up with those problems regarding suits being filed in court.
Right, and you're saying that it's actually better to have a trust than yes. to have a will. What's the difference?
Okay. In a will, when you leave that will behind and it is discovered, or you leave it with a lawyer or your heirs, this is required to be probated. Probated means you go to court, whether while you're still alive or after your death, there will be a testator, administrator, or somebody who is executor of the will. No, the testator is the one who writes the will. And this will have to go to court. It has to be proved that you were the one who wrote the will. It has to be probated, because it has to be established that you were of sound mind and body. Right. You know, not just sound mind, but of body as well. Huh? So it takes a long time, and you have to publish this will so that any public or any person who is after making money, sometimes we look, oh, sino ba dito ang nag-iwan ng will? So, baka all of a sudden, you will see somebody saying, you know, I'm a lost son or a lost...
yeah, sure you are.
A lost child, you yeah. know? And that is what the problem is with that. On the other hand, a trust, once you have it executed, you just appoint a trustee, and the trustee doesn't have to go to court. That trustee will just implement whatever is contained in that living trust, which should be able to take the place of a will. It can contain the same provisions as that of a will without going to court.
Okay, so who should this individual be, the one executing what is put in the trust?
Well, it's a trust, because the one you leave behind as trustee should really be somebody you trust. If you put somebody who's, a banker, for example, and you create trust that is offered by a bank, the problem is usually they just come up with what is called the bare bones trust. Like, it's so generalized that sometimes there's too much power or too much discretion that's left with the banker. and they invest the money in investments that might not be good for the estate, you know. I'm not saying that to offend the banks, but it happens, you know. So it's always good to have somebody that you completely trust, either a child, a spouse, a really good friend who you know will protect your estate when you're not there anymore.
All right, lots of good advice. We're going to take a quick break now. We are, of course, with Attorney Vinzons-Chato, and we'll continue our discussion on estate planning in just a moment. Shoptalk will be right back.